What's up, people? It is Mental Health Mon Tuesday with a spiritual twist brought to you by your girl, Demetra Williams Pitts. And this week's episode is This is a Man's World, Part 2. All right, hold on to your bootstraps. With September being National Suicide Prevention Awareness Month, the topic for this week's episode is Rejection and IPV, or Intimate Partner Violence, with our focus being on the men. Last week, we talked about divorce and trauma. This week, as I previously mentioned, we're talking about rejection and IPV. Rejection is a normal part of life. Although these images may be painful, most of us have experienced one or multiple rejection events in our lives. For the most part, we take the hit and eventually move on. However, for some, the rejection becomes a part of our personality and can cause damage that we may not be aware of, although we've moved on. If the rejection occurred during childhood, it may have a lasting effect into our adult lives, causing us to be exceptionally anxious in social settings, on our jobs, and in close relationships. Let's take a look at some of the causes and effects of rejection and how it specifically affects men. Later on, we'll hear from our guests as they talk about their experiences. So what is rejection? Rejection and the fear of being rejected ranks among the most potent and distressing of everyday events that people experience. Emotional rejection is the feeling a person experiences when disappointed about not achieving something desired. Rejection by a loved one, a romantic relationship, job termination have the power to compromise the quality of a person's life. The act of rejection can make the person undergo a certain drop in positive emotion. The response can go from vague disappointment, sadness, and depression to anxiety, phobic behavior, or even stalking or forcibly abducting and rejecting a person. Rejection can have the same response effect as physical violence. Hands up, cover the face or vital areas. The upper body leans forward or away in order to retreat from the pain. It is almost as if there's a force pulling the body away from impending danger. Emotional rejection, those same feelings are internal. Our mental and emotional states are looking to moving away from the hurtful person or situation, just as if one was being physically attacked. These are responses to defense, and the subconscious mind does not or doesn't know the difference between the physical and the emotional pain. Yes, we're still talking about rejection. The desire for acceptance is the opposite of rejection, which is a driving force that keeps many people from being an authentic human being. Let me repeat that. The opposite of rejection is acceptance, which is also a driving force that keeps many people from being an authentic human being. People who operate out of fear of rejection often display little or no assertiveness. They do not speak up and let others know how they feel about something, especially if their opinions differ. Far too many people let the fear of rejection and their desire for acceptance become the motivating forces for all their actions. Persons who operate out of fear of rejection all too often end up pushing away the very people who care for them the most. So what are some of the causes? Causes can range from physical conditions that the person believes makes them unattractive to being rejected as a child or having been abandoned or unloved. A traumatic experience that deeply scarred them. Never been exposed to healthy ways of dealing with conflict or disagreement. Lack of healthy self-concept, sense of self-worth, or positive self-esteem. What are the outcomes? These outcomes can lead to codependent, clingy, obsessive, jealous, or angry behavior. It can drive others away, can cause you to reject others to avoid being rejected. The fear of rejection can result in very damaging pattern of emotion and behavior that cause real hurt to relationships and the enjoyment in life. In an article, Why Men Can't Handle Rejection from Women, it is stated that marriage and family therapist John Odimo, PhD, writes in Psychology Today, the human brain, when faced with rejection, falls apart because it is one of our deepest human fears. Rejection confirms our worst fear, that we're possibly unloved or have little value. When these fear-based thoughts keep spinning in our mind, we become agitated, he says. To a certain extent, men don't expect women to beat them in any sphere. And as women enter new domains where men have been dominant, they are feeling threatened. This new world has left men anxious and they have no visible signs of coping. Hence, they lash out. Now, clinical psychologist Dr. Raja Metra says, causes of extreme violence stems from men's fear of losing their identity to assertive women. The men I've talked to in therapy, the ones who have injured or murdered women, have confessed that they were actually scared of women. Their identity came crumbling down, and to regain control, they resorted to extreme violence. Where does this skewed sense of entitlement come from? Dr. McCurkey, assistant professor of sociology at the Woman's Christian College, says the social conditioning of entitlement begins quite early in life, and women too play a part in making men believe the patriarchal narrative. Most men are brought up to believe the best goes to them. At the dinner table, the best portion is reserved for the father or son. They are learning early on from their wives, mothers, that getting the best piece of everything in life is natural, especially from a woman. The same applies when they are pursuing women later in life. They think women cannot say no to their proposal or be disinterested in them. With especially disastrous results in a society in transition, where regressive patriarchal ideas are clashing with modern reality on a daily basis. It is also written that society has wrongly pivoted this masculinity theory. Boys don't cry. Men are the sole breadwinners. Once such an image is set, it puts the man under extreme duress to conform to that standard. Then sociologist McCurkey says again, women will, when rejected, think this is my fate. They internalize it. It's more fatalistic for them. Most men don't think that way. They won't curse their fate. They'd say, fine, I'm going to teach this girl a lesson. We also have this thing called rejection sensitivity, which are those who are fearful and aversive to rejection, that it impacts their daily lives. These people expect to be rejected all the time. They also may feel the need to be liked by everyone. Here are some of the signs of rejection sensitivity. Constantly look for signs that they're about to be rejected. Tend to misinterpret, distort, or overreact to what other people say and do. Often misinterpret or overreact to various facial expressions. Experience heightened physiological activity. Remain alert or cues that they're about to be rejected, the fight or flight behavior. Often distort and misinterpret the actions of others. Experience attention bias. Vigilant in observing and monitoring the moods and behaviors of others, and are overly sensitive to interpersonal problems, may look for proof to confirm the rejection. Now, I put a pin right here, and please note that some people who operate vigilantly observing and monitoring moods and behaviors could also be victims of those with personality disorders, such as narcissism, borderline, and histrionic personality disorder. Now, what mental issues may arise due to rejection sensitivity? Rejection is a direct threat to an individual's sense of belonging and can have serious consequences for mental health. Even if someone isn't actually being rejected all the time, if they perceive that they are an outcast or if they believe they're being rejected, their mental health is still likely to decline. However, rejection sensitivity isn't a mental health diagnosis on its own, but it is associated with several different mental illnesses. For example, rejection sensitivity is a risk factor for developing depression and can worsen existing symptoms. Other studies have found that individuals who are high in rejection sensitivity are also at a higher risk of anxiety, body dysmorphic disorder, borderline personality disorder, and loneliness. I had to put another pin in it because in the case of men, loneliness is quite prevalent, which is why they tend to jump right into a new relationship, as it was referenced last week during our divorce episode. Now that we've covered the facts surrounding rejection and rejection sensitivity, let's hear from our guest as it relates to rejection. Later on, we'll hear them respond to questions relating to IPV and their mental health experiences or the lack thereof. But first, let me welcome back these brave, kind, intelligent, and willing men from Chicago that took out their time to respond to my request. They're all friends of mine that I've known for quite some time. Each are talented, gifted, and creative in their own right. Again, this is a cross-generational group, as it was important to get responses from different life experiences and journeys. First, I'd like to introduce Markel Stewart. Markel is a veteran in the finance industry, has one child that's currently in college and doing exceptionally well, is a lover of gospel music, one of the best tenors I've ever encountered, hails from the great west side of Chicago, and a diehard, I mean diehard, Chicago Bears fan. Next, Sir Walter Jones, music producer, composer, musician, online marketing expert, teacher of theology, church elder, father of two beautiful young adults, creator and host of The Sir Walter Jones Show, which airs every day of the week on Facebook and YouTube. Be sure to check him out. Lastly, Corwin Corky Calhoun, retired captain of the Chicago Police Department, where he served for 31 years throughout the city of Chicago, semi-master chef and host with the most, an absolute lover of family, along with his two ferocious cane corsos. All three of these men are blessed, gifted, and talented. Therefore, this introduction merely scratches the surface. So let's see what they have to say. Question 3. Rejection is ranked among the most potent and distressing within everyday life that people experience. As it relates to dating in particular, can you describe how rejection affected you? Did it change your method of approaching women and deciding whether you would develop a relationship with them?
Question 3 about rejection from women, especially in dating. Again, it affected me as if it was a divorce. It made me feel like something was wrong with me. I was ugly. I was too skinny. I was not smart enough. I was, something was wrong with me, that rejection. And it was like, how could that be? I thought that I had it all together. I thought I had the suave. I thought I was charismatic. I thought, but then this woman rejects me. How could that be when people say they like me and they... So it did cut me in half, indeed. And so it did, again, cause me to be isolated and not date, not approach women, and just be the nerd that I was known to be and just stay at work, you know, don't go to any events. And I was invited to a lot of parties, but I rejected it, you know. And then if I did go to a party, they would ask me to dance, and I wouldn't. They would ask me to sit at certain tables. I wouldn't. Just shy or just fear of rejection. That was me. People don't see that today. They were like, that's impossible. But I think there's a misnomer. People think that the person is, because they're very public, like I am, that they think that I am constantly approaching people and the life of the party, blah, blah, blah. And yes, I can be that, but there is that part of me that people don't see. The people who know me, they see it and they know it. But it's easy to hide behind the computer screen when you're doing what I do for a living through social media. But in public, I can be quite boring and shy.
Rejection is a, how can I put this? Rejection is a confidence killer. It can make you feel very low, very unwanted. It is distressing, and it can inhibit you from approaching the people that you like the most, the people that you really want to be involved in. And you can carry that on into adult life. And as far as approaching somebody after that, what method do you use? If you're wise enough, you realize that wait for somebody that really likes you. Then you got a real chance.
So I find this question in regards to rejection a little interesting. When you're younger as a male, rejection means nothing. It's just on to the next. It is sensationalized for you to talk to whoever you want, when you want, to do whatever you want when you get ready. And so, of course, playing the game that way, you're going to be told no. And so you build up a tolerance for no. No just sharpens your tool to make you look at what I could have said or did differently to get what it was that I wanted. However, you get older and you decide that at some point you want to settle down. You take a more methodical approach in the way that you approach women. And so in that methodical approach, you show yourself friendly and you present yourself as a gentleman and you befriend her. And she still may very well reject you. Rejection, being a little older, is a little embarrassing. It can cause some apprehension. The apprehension may come later when where it very well may be someone who is for you, but you are too afraid to approach that woman because of what happened the last time. I myself take rejection a little bit differently. I just look at it as that's God's way of protecting me from someone that I should not be with.
Intimate partner violence. Although these images are heartbreaking, unfortunately, they are the experiences that some men currently face on a regular basis. Let's look at some stats. Intimate partner violence, or IPV. Male victimization is a significant public health problem, according to estimates in the National Intimate Partner and Sexual Violence Survey. Approximately 1 in 10 men in the U.S. experience contact sexual violence, physical violence, and or stalking by an intimate partner during their lifetime and reported some form of IPV-related impact. Most first-time victimizations occur before the age of 25, with many victims first experiencing violence before age 18. About 1 in 3 men experience contact sexual violence, physical violence, and or stalking by an intimate partner during their lifetime. Nearly 56% of men who were victims of contact and sexual violence, physical violence, and or stalking and by an intimate partner first experience these or other forms of violence by that partner before age 25. About 1 in 14 men in the U.S. were made to penetrate someone during their lifetime. More than 1 in 38 men in the U.S. experienced completed or attempted rape victimization in their lifetime. Among male victims of completed or attempted rape, About 71% first experienced such victimization prior to age 25. About 1 in 17 men in the U.S. were victims of stalking at some point in their lifetime. Nearly 41% of male victims first experienced stalking before the age of 25. Just so we have some clarity between the difference in rape and MTP. MTP is made to penetrate, which is a form of sexual violence that some in the practice field consider similar to rape. The CDC measures rape and MTP as separate concepts and views the two as distinct types of violence with potentially different consequences. Given the burden of these forms of violence in the lives of Americans, it is important to understand the difference in order to raise awareness. Rape entails any completed or attempted unwanted penetration of the victim through the use of physical force, or when the victim was unable to consent due to being too drunk, high, or drugged, for example, incapacitation, lack of consciousness, or lack of awareness, from their voluntary or involuntary use of alcohol or drugs. Being MTP occurs when the victim was made to, or there was an attempt to make them, sexually penetrate someone without consent as a result of physical force, or when the victim is unable to consent due to being too drunk, high, or drugged, for example, incapacitation, lack of consciousness, or lack of awareness, from their voluntary or involuntary use of alcohol or drugs. That is directly from the CDC. Intimate partner violence. 97% of men who experienced rape, physical violence, or stalking by an intimate partner had only female perpetrators. Here are some of the myths as it relates to IPV against men. Men can't be victims of abuse. A lie. Men are not real men if they can't take it. A lie. Men don't have access to the same resources as women. A lie. The media tells us men are just the perpetrators of violence, but never the victims. A big lie. Men who are gay or bisexual will bring shame to the LGBTQ plus community if they report being victims of abuse. A lie. That sources National Domestic Violence Hotline. Talking about abuse and domestic violence can be a very difficult task for anyone. It can be painful, confusing, and make you feel ashamed, inadequate, and isolated. And it can be incredibly challenging when you are a man because of all the stigma, fear, misinformation, and societal pressures that only men seem to experience. We know that while domestic violence does not discriminate when it comes to gender, men seem to not report abuse in the same way women do. In fact, many men remain silent because they think there's no point in reporting the abuse because no one will ever believe them. From an article in the Journal of Family Violence, here are some of the types as well as some of the behaviors of intimate partner violence. Being slapped, hit, 43.7%. Pushed, 41.8%. Kicked, 39.2%. Grabbed, 31%. Punched, 24.7%, choked, 22.2%, spat on, stabbed, or scratched, a total of 12.7%. Here are some of the behaviors that the perpetrator uses. Coercion and threats, 77.6%. Emotional abuse, 74.1%. Intimidation, 63.3%. Blaming, minimizing, and denying, 59.9%. Manipulating the system, oh, it's them, not me, 50.3%. Isolation, 41.5%. Economic abuse, 38.1%. And using the children, 64.5%. These are actual statistics from the Domestic Abuse Helpline for Men. Here are some characteristics of the abuser. Partner has a history of childhood trauma, 91.7%. Partner has threatened suicide, 61.9%. Partner has threatened homicide, 59%. Partner uses alcohol, 52.1%. Partner has a mental illness, 46%. And partner uses drugs, 34.8%. When men are victimized by women, they may be additionally victimized through their dealings with domestic violence advocates. Now, that's a source from the Journal of Family Violence. Again, these are actual statistics from those that conducted, that were contacted through the domestic abuse hotline or helpline for men. More than 830,000 men fall victim to domestic violence every year, which means every 37.8 seconds, that means before I finish this, somewhere in America, a man is being battered, according to the National Violence Against Women Survey. At the end of this episode of Mental Health Monday Tuesday, there will be resource information for your assistance. Back to our guest, question four. According to the CDC and the National Intimate Partner and Sexual Violence Survey, nearly a quarter of men in the U.S. reported some form of contact sexual violence in their lifetime. Approximately 1 in 10 men in the U.S. experienced contact sexual violence, physical violence, and or stalking by an intimate partner during their lifetime and reported some form of IPV-related impact. Commonly reported IPV related impacts among male victims were fear, concern for safety, and symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder, among others. Have you experienced any of these events? If so, how has it or does it affect your approach to future intimate relationships?
So I have never been a victim of sexual violence or stalked that I know of. I will tell you a story though, quick story. So I was maybe 19 or so, and I was dating someone who's at that time would be considered considerably older than me, maybe about 10, 11 years, something to that effect. Not serious for me at all, but perhaps for her. To this day, I have no idea how she found out, but it doesn't matter. I was dealing with someone that she knew of, to the point where she knew where this person lived. And so one late night, I am leaving this particular person's home, and as I step out into the street, the woman who was supposed to be my girlfriend at the time attempted to run me over with her car. After that, I never saw or have spoken to her since. But it also made me realize that you never know what somebody is capable of in their moment of anger. And so the real lesson in that was to be careful and be aware of who and what you are dealing with.
Question number four, sexual violence. No, that has never happened to me. It's really ironic or sad that some men actually want it to happen to them because they see, especially men who are very sexual, they would love for a woman to do that to them until it's done to them, and then they don't realize that this is a psychological a problem here. It can be. We always say what we want until it happens to us, but it has never happened to me. There was some attempt of sexual attack by a male while I was in college. The secretary of the band director was a homosexual, and he did touch me inappropriately, trying to lure me into his home. And I was 17, 18 years old, and it disturbed me greatly, and it caused me to run away and quit the band, and eventually I left college. Yeah, that part, absolutely. But as far as a female is concerned, no, I never had that to happen to me.
Initially, I started not to answer this question about sexual violence. In my lifetime, during my upbringing, I never experienced any of it. From police experience, I know that there are a lot of people that have, but I did not. nor did I know of any violence within my family. Cousins, uncles, aunts, my parents, and my grandparents, our family history was devoid of any of that type of nonsense. So I wasn't exposed to it. But I got to thinking, better judgment took over as far as being a young adult. Cute, pretty, and beautiful should never be the foundation and basis of a relationship. I met a young lady that was cute, pretty, beautiful, and seemed to be the things that I desired in an immature state. She turned out to be a pariah. She wanted to do whatever she wanted to do, and she did not want me going anywhere. You have got to be aware of people's personalities, more particularly their capabilities. There was a time about 1990, 1991, somebody that I was seriously dating. I did not know her history. It's just cute, pretty, and beautiful. But she had a history, and a nasty history. She tried to have me killed. She tried her best to have me killed. And not by any chumps or street punks. It was through organized crime. And they were not playing. Fortunately, I survived. These were not nice people at all. I ran into the same young lady about 2 years ago. I was in a 7-Eleven. I walked in to get me a slushy or whatever you call those things, freezies or whatever. Door opened. Somebody walked in. She exchanged pleasantries with the cashier. And I thought she sounded like a really nice lady. I turned around to check her out. She smiled at me with a very eerie smile. And I saw it in her eyes, the way she looked at me. I can kill you anytime I get ready. She didn't say that, but I saw it in her eyeballs. My point is this. Be careful of who you decide to date and why you decide to date them. Try and know as much history about that person as you can. You could be essentially dating a nut. You could get married to a complete idiot. Don't fall in love with sex. Don't fall in love with cuteness, beauty, prettiness. That's my violence story. I'll leave you where I found you.
Let's talk men and mental health. Nearly 1 in 4 women received mental health treatment, 24.7%, in the past 12 months compared to 13.4% of men. Women were more likely than men to have taken medication for their mental health, 20.6% and 10.7% respectively, and to have received counseling or therapy from a mental health professional, 11.7% and 7.2% in the past 12 months. Non-Hispanic Black adults, 8.1%, were more likely to have received counseling or therapy compared with Hispanic adults, which are 6.6%. Once again, I really appreciate my friends for participating in this men's segment of Mental Health Mon Tuesday, but had to ask them one final question as it relates to mental health and their experiences with statistics from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. It shows that men are less likely to seek assistance than women, and yet Blacks are more likely to seek assistance than Hispanics. Given just the small amount of information, it is probably safe to surmise that the Black man is low on the totem pole as it relates to seeing a mental health professional. However, let's listen in to see what our guests have to say on this subject. Final question, number 5. Have you considered seeing a mental health professional? If you have or did, What was your experience like, and would you recommend it to other Black men? If you haven't, what's your reason for not doing so?
There are plenty of us that need to see a mental health professional, but I think that particularly with African-American men, it is looked, they view it as a weakness, so you don't want to seek help. You don't want that psychiatrist or psychologist to be analyzing you and talking to you. African-American men have had enough dynamics in life where they feel less than. As I spoke in the top question about the traumatic events and how you're viewed or looked upon, those dynamics. Well, that's just one more to add to it, and that's one more thing to destroy your confidence or what's the right word? Self-confidence. Let's just say self-confidence. That's just one more thing. You've dealt with childhood trauma. You've dealt with rejection. And now you got to go see somebody because your head ain't right. But you may need to go see somebody. I've considered it personally. I have considered it myself. Depending on what types of trauma and the different things you deal with. I had three very special people to die in my close proximity within a year and a half. And that can take a toll on you. And I've been told I need to go see somebody. So, and I've told different friends that they needed to. I suggested it to them. Because I have lost, especially being in law enforcement, you have the instrument of death with you all the time. You got that gun. And I have had too many close friends, very close friends, to take their lives. And I wonder if they had talked to somebody, they never would have done it. And then on my end, takes a whole lot out of you, but I've talked the gun out of different friends' mouths. I've stopped them. It takes a lot out of you.
So I have considered seeing a mental health professional. As of right now, I have not. There have been some things that I've been through in my life that you would say, hey, you probably should have went to see a health professional a long time ago. However, growing up in the Black church, they'll tell you that it isn't necessary, that all you need to do is pray it away or read this scripture and it'll be an outline for your life. And although it is an outline for your life, God created the mental health professional even for his own people, because he already knew that there'd be some trying times in this life that we need to speak to somebody who has an unbiased opinion about what it is that you can do to better your life. I believe that in speaking to a mental health professional, that we as Black men can move past some of the trauma from childhood, from school, from relationships, and even from growing up in the Black church. as of right now, I have not sought out any mental professional help. I do plan to do just that for my own well-being. And I would recommend that any black man that has gone through any type of trauma, and again, whether it be childhood or whether it be on the job or past relationships, that you seek that help for your own betterment. And not only just for you, but for your children, or maybe some of you have grandchildren, or for your spouse, or most importantly, for yourself.
Question number 5, have I seen or considered mental health professional? Not deeply, no. I pretty much know, either knew or know what my mental health status was or is. I did seek marriage counseling, and I looked at it as a mental health evaluation. I did do that. So I guess I can say I killed 2 birds with 1 stone. And he walked me through some of the steps that I believe that I needed, because he took me back into the past and some things that I forgot about. And it was brought up in the session, and it helped me. And it helped me help others as well. So I'm a strong advocate for mental health, especially through black men who experience so much trauma in their neighborhoods, in their homes, at their school, you know, and police brutality, or just the things that they've seen. I'm absolutely for it. So I right now think that I'm in a healthy state mentally, that I don't need to go, but I don't represent maybe some of my other brothers out there. When I say brothers, I mean African-American brothers. I believe that I have witnessed many in the church world who I believe need to. I adjure them to go see a mental health professional. They need to. And it would help curtail a lot of the misconduct in our churches. And some of the things that we see that we call church hurt, it would really help a lot of that. But it's a taboo subject.
Of course there's a spiritual twist, Romans 12:2. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Let's do NLT. It's a little easier to read. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Now, the Greek word for mind is nous, N-O-U-S, meaning the mind, the reason, the reasoning faculty, intellect, the God-given capacity for each person to think, which is reason, the mind, the mental capacity to exercise reflective thinking. Specifically for the believer, it is the organ of receiving God's thoughts through faith. As it relates to the mind, according to the scripture, the mind serves as a vital organ in order to be able to operate as the believer should, as it is the conduit to receiving God's thoughts through faith, which concerns your entire life. Therefore, I would surmise that if one is concerned with following God's word, will, and way, perhaps seeking a mental health professional would assist in clearing some of the clutter and trauma that has built up in your mind, because that will be beneficial in you walking this walk of faith. Thank you again for listening to Mental Health Mon Tuesday with a Spiritual Twist. As this concludes our series of This is a Man's World, again, I'd like to thank my guests for their participation. I couldn't have done it without them. They are the best. As promised above, you will find resources if you are in immediate danger that are available to assist you on your journey. If you need additional resources relating to counseling, contact SAMSHA, which is the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, at the number listed above, which is 1-800-662-HELP or 1-800-662-4357. Please don't hesitate to reach out, because your mental health affects your physical health. Let's make it a priority to have a happy, healthy, functioning mind. This is Demetra Williams-Pitts. I holla!